gifts that were given, pray that you will magnify him, get your name up even more. He wants to see you in us. And give Pastor Mike here the words we need to hear about your name. Amen.
Video helpful for this morning's sermon, and actually almost in general for our series, obviously for a number of reasons, because if we think about this story that we're going through in the book of Ruth, and we think about the perspective of Naomi, she, especially in the land of Moab, as we've already talked about, with the death of her husband, with the death of her children, she may be seeing things from the side. She may be seeing things of just found garbage or found items that are just scattered about without seeing exactly what God is doing. And then we start to see us as the hearers of this story being told, because we know that this was obviously a story that was read, so this was primarily not something that was read individually, but read aloud for an audience to hear, and they start to see the tapestry being woven together into this story that God is bringing about. And in fact, we get a view this morning in our text that we'll look at from chapter 2, verses 1 through 16, where this story starts to become even a little bit more clear. In fact, we as the hearers of the story, or the readers of the story, find even more information. We start to get God's perspective on the story just a little bit. And this is helpful for us because we've been held in tension for that first chapter where Naomi has been going through nothing but grief and trial. She has lost her husband. She has lost her children, and she's left with her two daughters-in-law, one of which returns home, even at the request of Naomi, so that she's honest with her daughters-in-law, that their fate and what they await going into a foreign land, or at least Naomi's native land, but their foreign land, and but Ruth clings to her. And so from the perspective of either the characters, or even at times us as the audience, we are seeing things from the side. We are not necessarily seeing what God is doing and weaving together this masterful tale. But we start to get a glimpse, we start to get a picture that Naomi's tragedy is going to become an opportunity for something to blossom into a beautiful story, a beautiful tale of redemption, a beautiful story of going from emptiness to fullness. So I thought that picture, that video was helpful. It's actually a gentleman from West Michigan. Actually, I think he went to school at Freeport. And Chad Sieber is his name, and he does a wonderful work in regards to art and doing it and tying it into God's story. So I thought that that would be helpful for us, because so often the times when even we're walking through our own valley of the shadow of death, we can be wondering, what is God doing in this? And we have to bear with, and like we talked about the last couple weeks, we have to realize and handle the fact that we may not always have Naomi's perspective. We may not always get Ruth's point of view. There may be times where we are Chilion and Malon or Elimelech. But we have to trust in the God who does have his perspective, his view on things, and that even when we're walking through pain and suffering, that God can and will use it for our good and for his glory. And that isn't often a very comfortable position to be in. We have to admit that. We have to admit that that's often very painful. That's where that trust comes in. That's where that faith in who God is, the fact that he is the faithful covenant God, the one who holds up his end of the bargain, that we are serving him and him alone. And so while we do walk through these terrible situations in our lives, and as we talked about a little bit this morning, Tim brought it up, that this season of life, the season of holidays, these holy days that we're going to be going into, just having celebrated Thanksgiving and moving into Christmas, celebrating the coming of our Savior, can bring up pains and memories of people that are no longer with us, or a myriad of different things that can bring us down. But as we talked about in Sunday school, and if those of you familiar with Ephesians 6, we can put on, in fact, we're commanded to put on the full armor of God. So if you are walking through your own valley of the shadow of death this morning, if you're walking through suffering and pain in a situation that you don't know how it's going to play out, I invite you to read Ephesians 6 this week. Maybe read it every morning. And remind yourself that God has provided you the armor as well as the power in which to yield it. So that would be my prayer for you this morning, as well as the prayer for our time. And after going through Ephesians 6, maybe come back to the story of Ruth and remind yourself of the covenant faithfulness of God. And that sending Christ to the cross, he has given us hope. And it's a no-so hope, not a I-hope-so hope. It's a no-so that God will deliver you ultimately in the end. And to not get skewed by the world's definition of what good is when it comes to God does have your good in mind. But realize that God is using you for your good as he defines, as it is from his perspective. Looked at purely from a human perspective, when we think about the story of Ruth, we see this first chapter and it's almost pure chaos. We have over a decade of activity where Elimelech and Naomi and their sons leave Bethlehem, the city of bread, because of the famine. They begin to take activities or take control of their own destiny, if you will, and leave God's promised land, and they go to the land of Moab. We talked a little bit about Moab last week, so I won't belabor this time of the sermon with more details about Moab, but Moab was not a city with a very strong history or a very wise beginning. But it's a city that often warred and battled with Israel. But this may have been a time of peace if they were allowed to go and settle in these fields. Her sons take daughters from the land of Moab. Elimelech, her husband, dies. The sons die, and then she returns. And Ruth returns with her, that repenting returning. Ruth makes a declaration that her people, Naomi's people, the Israelites, will be her people, and her God will be, Naomi's God will be her God. She's turning from her pagan lifestyle, turning to the God of the universe. And she's saying, your people will be my people. So we can look at this and see a story of chaos, or we can look and see, thankfully, the author is now going to give us a little bit of a hint of hope for Naomi at the beginning of chapter 2, and we'll look at that here in a minute. But what we see now from God's perspective, as we get the pleasure of hearing the story of Ruth, we see from God's perspective that these random occurrences, they're bad decisions to leave God's promised land. The judgment, the famine had come upon that. And then the two remaining characters, the widowed and childless foreigner in the land of Moab and the Moabite woman herself a widow, are part of the beautiful tapestry that God is weaving to ultimately bring light into the world. This is Jesus' lineage. This is King David's lineage, which leads to Jesus Christ, David's son and Lord. They are part of the cocoon of life that will metamorphosize into the lineage of the great King David and finally unfurl its wings into the God-man, the Messiah, the long-awaited Savior, Jesus Christ. A very appropriate storyline for this time of year. Yes, you and I are no longer waiting for the promised Messiah to come, and so our story is not going to be captured into the pages of Scripture. However, God is not done working in this world. He is at work in your lives today, right now. Look for his autograph. Look for his handwriting in your life. Vie for his perspective. See that he is drawing from the ink well of Christ's blood to write your name in the Lamb's book of life. And maybe using you as that seed in someone else's life, as we see him using Naomi to call Ruth into faith. See that from your perspective, it may look discombobulated. It may look like a lamppost, a discarded door, a helmet, some spray-painted parts. But from God's view, it is that beautiful butterfly getting ready to give life, under whose wings we can find shelter. So please stand with me as we read from Ruth chapter 2, verses 1 through 16, as we start to see this story of God's redemption playing out. Begin reading in Ruth 2, verse 1. Now Naomi had a relative of her husband's, a worthy man of the clan of Elimelech, whose name was Boaz. And Ruth the Moabite said to Naomi, "Let me go to the field and glean among the ears of grain after him in whose sight I shall find favor." And she said to her, "Go, my daughter." So she set out and went and gleaned in the fields after the reapers, and she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the clan of Elimelech. Verse 4, "And behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem, and he said to the reapers, 'The Lord be with you.' And they answered, 'The Lord bless you.' Then Boaz said to his young man who was in charge of the reapers, 'Whose young woman is this?' And the servant who was in charge of the reapers answered, 'She is the young Moabite woman who came back with Naomi from the country of Moab. She said, "Please let me glean and gather among the sheaves after the reapers." So she came and she has continued from early morning until now, except for a short rest." Verse 8, "Then Boaz said to Ruth, 'Now listen, my daughter. Do not go to glean in another field or leave this one, but keep close to my women. Let your eyes be on the field that they are reaping and go after them. Have I not charged the young men not to touch you? And when you are thirsty, go to the vessels and drink what the young men have drawn.' Then she fell on her face, bowing to the ground, and said to him, 'Why have I found favor in your eyes that you should take notice of me since I am a foreigner?' But Boaz answered her, 'All that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband has been fully told to me, and how you left your father and mother and your native land and came to a people that you did not know before. The Lord repay you for what you have done, and a full reward be given you by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge.' Then she said, 'I have found favor in your eyes, my Lord, for you have comforted me and have spoken kindly to your servant, though I am not one of your servants.' Verse 14, "And at mealtime, Boaz said to her, 'Come here, eat some bread, dip your morsel in the wine.' So she sat beside the reapers, and he passed to her roasted grain. And she ate until she was satisfied, and she had some left over. When she rose to glean, Boaz instructed his young men, saying, 'Let her glean among even the sheaves, and do not reproach her. And also pull out some from the bundles for her, and leave it for her to glean, and do not rebuke her.' This is the word of the Lord." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this dawning of new hope for both Ruth and Naomi. Father, we thank you that you have captured this wonderful historical account in Scripture so that we can learn much about who you are, Lord, and how you use people. Father, you call us to faithfulness to you because you are utterly faithful to us. You are a God with unfailing mercy and grace. And let us see that portrait painted beautifully for us before us in this book of Ruth. Lord, we are seeing a foreshadow of the coming of Christ, in whose valley we now stand, hearing the echoes of his grace calling from the cross, Lord, calling us to repentance and faith and trusting in him and in him alone. Lord, let the service be an offering to you. Let it instruct us in the Holy Spirit, and let it be pleasing to the ears of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. So thank you for your patience in reading 16 verses, but that story has to be heard in its entirety without me interjecting, pretending that I'm adding something to it, which I'll actually pretend to do for the next 30 minutes. This story is absolutely rich with detail. Much like the armor of God that we talked about in Sunday school, there's so much more here than I get from my first cursory reading that I am so thankful and indebted to a number of scholars that have written books that are actually approachable, which I really, really appreciate. There are many books that are written where I go, what are you talking about? Especially when it comes to Hebrew, I know just a fraction of Hebrew that I do of Greek, and Hebrew is still Greek to me in many respects. But the Hebrew language is precise, just like Greek, and it is filled with so many interesting details that can get lost in a faithful translation, because our translators are doing their best to capture, each Bible has its own thread of interpretation in terms of what their goal is, whether it's thought for thought or word for word. But no matter what, things are going to be lost in translation that would have hit the original audience's ears, just like, wow, look what God is doing. And our interpretations do a great job of trying to capture that. We're just limited. We're passing from one language to another. Things will get lost and meanings will become shallow that were once deep. So I'm thankful for the scholars who have helped uncover some of those deep recesses in which we can go and soak up what God has for us, especially in this story, because they are all over the place. As we've seen before, with the repetition, with the use of names, with famine and coming back to the Bethlehem, the house of bread, which now again has bread, we have them now coming into Bethlehem at the time of the barley harvest. So they're rich, the fields are ready for harvesting and for even gleaning. So our passage for this morning begins by revealing a detail then in verse 1 to the audience, to the hearers, that is not now known to the characters. So verse 1 is immediately almost okay, you guys have been hanging with Naomi for the first chapter, and things have been rough for her. I mean, we're talking about a decade of really pain and suffering in Moab, and a return with now a Moabite woman into a patriarchal, a male-dominated society where she really had no security. So we are left clinging at the end of chapter 1 with Naomi even saying, don't even call me Pleasant. Don't even call me Naomi anymore. Call me Mara, for I am bitter. She is forced to walk a bitter path. And she's walking that still trusting in her Lord. She doesn't say that chaos or happenstance has brought her this bitterness. It's at the hand of the Lord that she has suffered and wants to be called Mara, if you will. But for the rest of the story, the author refers to her as Naomi. There's hope. So verse 1 of chapter 2 then says, now Naomi, now Pleasant, if you will, had a relative of her husband's, a worthy man of the clan of Elimelech, whose name was Boaz. And it's interesting, in Hebrew culture, in the Hebrew language, in the Israelite culture, you often name somebody and then explain their qualities. And this was actually reversed in verse 1. Now Naomi had a relative of her husband's. We're getting introduced to a major character, and it's a relative of Naomi's husband, letting us know that Naomi's suffering is soon coming to an end. This is an olive branch to the audience, saying you're hanging with Naomi, she's suffering. Rest in the promises of God that her suffering is coming to an end. Naomi doesn't know this yet, of course, but Naomi had a relative of her husband, this is Boaz, a worthy man. The word worthy carries with it many connotations. It can mean a man of means. It can mean he had wealth. But I think that the connotation that's meant here is, especially by what's followed in the narrative, is that he's a man of substance, of character, of morality. He's a man of the Lord who can be trusted. That's inherent, that's included in the title of worthy man. It's not a jump by interpreters to come to that. That's part of the meaning. And I believe it may even be all of the above, because of Boaz certainly had means as well. He's got a field and he has hired workers. So it could mean all of those qualities captured into one. He is a worthy man. And he's of the clan of Elimelech, whose name was Boaz. So we know now, especially to the Jewish ears, that this idea of kinsman redeemer, and we'll talk about it in greater detail next week, but this idea that there's going to be someone who can redeem this family, who can provide for this family who's lost everything, is available. This is a deep sigh for the audience at this point. It's a, okay, Naomi's, we're starting to see she may be okay. But Naomi, again, is not privy to this information. God didn't say, hey, Naomi, did you read 2 verse 1? So she's still out there. And then Boaz is a name that's unique in this particular writing is unique to the scripture, unique even to Hebrew writing in general. And the meaning of Boaz is not entirely known. There's one theory which I like, but we have to understand it's a theory. And I think that his character backs this up, but it basically means the Lord Almighty is my strength. He is my, who I will do. And they get that from coming up with an acrostic with the letters of his name, Boaz, each one meaning something. It's pure speculation, but I think his character backs it up. So even if that's not what the author intended, even if that's not what Boaz's parents intended by naming this, I would say he stands up to this, especially with the man who is of worthy character, as the author describes in verse 1. Then we come to verse 2, and Ruth the Moabite. Well, we're reminded again of Ruth's heritage. She's a Moabite. Like, man, author, lay off already. We get it. This is important, because when this concept of gleaning in a field for given to Israel from the mouth of the Lord, there's three places. There's two in Deuteronomy, and there's one in, I believe it's in Numbers, that gives us instructions. It gives Israel instructions on gleaning. And gleaning is the process of when you harvest a field, leaving stuff around the edges. So, you know, you would harvest, but you'd leave the corners, you'd leave the edges, you'd leave grain standing. It also means if you happen to drop anything that's going to be put into your sheave, into your bundle, you'd leave that on the ground as well. That's the process of, that's the instructions that are given to Israel. And those three different spots in the Old Testament that give these instructions make that provisions available for the poor, for the widowed, as well as for the sojourner. So by the author repeating the fact that she is a Moabite here is letting us know that Ruth is a widow, so she's got one qualification she can glean. She's also a Moabite. She is sojourning in this land. So it's like she has every right to be in this field to glean. And obviously we also see Ruth, under maybe even knowing this, maybe Naomi has instructed her, because in her call, in her plea to Naomi, verse 2 says, "And Ruth the Moabite said to Naomi, 'Let me go to the field and glean among the ears of grain, after him in whose sight I shall find favor.'" There's hope right there. Ruth isn't merely looking for grain. She's saying, I'm going to find favor here. And the word favor carries with it a judicial understanding. So we see romance later in this story. But at this point, Ruth isn't saying, let me go find, I'm going to christianmingle.com or hebrewgleaner.com and I'm going to find myself a man out in this field. She's basically saying, I want to find somebody. I'm a defendant before a judge. I want to find favor in this person's eyes. I want them to look on me and see that I am a widow. I am a sojourner. I am in need. Have mercy upon me. So with our eyes, when we know the story, we go, oh, look, she's hoping. Maybe she put on perfume. She did her hair to go out and glean. No, this is like, I just want to find favor. Ruth and Naomi came back empty to Bethlehem. We have no reason to believe she's going out there with a full stomach to glean. I guarantee you Naomi's stomach was growling and Ruth's was as well, if they had a place to stay. So there is hope. Now she's saying, I'm going to find favor in someone's eyes. It's almost like she heard Ruth's plea, Naomi's plea for her in chapter 1, verse 8, when she says, "But Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, 'Go, return each of you to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and me.'" It's almost like she's saying, God is going to deal kindly with me. I'm going to go and I'm going to find favor. She's going expectantly. We've talked a little bit about that with our prayers, don't we? Shouldn't we pray expectantly? We have a God who hears and who answers. And then at times that answer will be no, or it may even be wait. But it still, yes, is on the table. She's going expectantly here in verse 2 of chapter 2. And then that verse closes, and she, Naomi, said to her, "Go, my daughter." Not go, my daughter-in-law. There is belonging now. Ruth says to Naomi, back in the land of Moab on their trip to Bethlehem, "Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God." And here Naomi says, "Go, my daughter." That's love. That's inclusion. That's saying you're starting to become an Israelite. And we'll see that theme carried out even in this chapter. Verse 3 then, so she, Ruth, set out and went and gleaned in the fields after the reapers. So obviously this in this area of outside of Bethlehem, we come to know, was fields. There's a series of fields, and she's gleaning. And it's important to know that at this time, especially in the time of the judges, that... Look for Kleenex, so I'm not rubbing my nose. I'm grossing you guys out. not a safe time for women to be out without protection. This was a time where women were routinely and regularly abused and violated in every sense of that word if they were out and about. It wasn't a guarantee, but it certainly happened enough to where this was not a safe prospect for Ruth. Ruth, a Moabite, with no husband, no protection. So she was fair game to those of ill repute, if you will. And so this was not a time for her just to kind of go gleaning and, hey, I got this, I'm whistling while I'm gleaning and picking things up. We also must remember that this is right after a famine. So I guarantee you those fields were picked pretty bare. They may have followed to the letter of the law, like, we'll leave a little bit on the edge. Because there is empty storehouses. This is the first harvest. This is the barley has come in. They're expecting this. And I guarantee you that a lot of empty stomachs were out in that field. So it wasn't safe for a woman who has no protection of name, or especially being Israelite, she's a foreigner. And also, this was a time of great want and need. So there's an idea here where she's gleaning in multiple fields, and she comes to a part of a field owned by Boaz. Again, unbeknownst to her. So verse 3, so she set out and went and gleaned in the fields after the reapers, and she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the clan of Elimelech. She happened to come. This literally reads, her chance chanced to come upon. So this is, again, a cue to the audience, like, from Ruth's perspective, she just happened to be there. From God's perspective, it's like, what did I tell you in verse 1? There's a guy named Boaz, the clan of Elimelech. But from Ruth's perspective, it's from that side view of that butterfly. This is still chaos. This is still multiple pieces spinning around. How is this all going to come together? And so her chance chanced. She happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was the clan of Elimelech. But we know that this tapestry is being woven together by God. This isn't just her happening. This happening by chance. And then and behold, literally, and see, like, look, here comes Boaz from Bethlehem. The owner of the field is going to stop by the field on the day when Ruth just happened to be in the field. I mean, this is a circumstance of circumstance. This is at the right place at the right time. But for God, it's like, it's just my plan. From our perspective, look at what happened. She chanced upon chance, and look, Boaz is there. The owner of the field's there. Probably had multiple fields. He may have. And oftentimes, the owners weren't out in the fields to watch over the harvest. They had other things going on. But here he is out in the field. So it's verse 4. And behold, look, Boaz came from Bethlehem. And we get an idea of Boaz's character, of how he is a worthy man right away. He says to his reapers, the Lord be with you. That is a blessing. That is a blessing in prayer. It is a greeting, and it may have even been commonplace, but the fact that the author captures that for us lets us know how and who this man Boaz was. How worthy was he? He's saying, the Lord be with you, and then they respond, the Lord bless you. This wasn't, there's a visitor in the field, I better be nice. The Lord be with you, because then all the reapers have been like, what? Bless you or something? What are we saying now? This is commonplace for them. He led under the Lord's leading. So these little details, I think, just add so much depth to the story. Then verse 5, then Boaz said to his young man who was in charge of the reapers, whose young woman is this? In a sense, he's saying, whose clan does she belong to? Who's her father? Who's her daughter? Who's her daughter? Who's her father? Who's her husband? Who's her brother? He's saying, who is this woman? Who does she belong to, essentially? And then Boaz said that to his young man who was in charge, the foreman, if you will, of the reapers. And then verse 6, and the servant who was in charge of the reapers answered back, she is the young Moabite woman who came back with Naomi from the country of Moab. And she said, this is the foreman quoting Ruth here, please let me glean and gather among the sheaves after the reapers. So she came and has continued from early morning until now except for a short rest. So we learned a couple things. First thing we learned is that her reputation was known. It's like, that's the Moabite. That's the one that you've heard came back with Naomi, who wants to be called Mara. This had permeated this society. There could have been 1,000 to 3,000 people in Bethlehem at this time, best estimates. So this story had permeated this culture. They're like, oh, Naomi's back. She's widowed, she's childless, and she has a Moabite woman with her. So we're reminded again of Ruth's heritage. But we're also, as we'll hear, and we did hear when we read it, Boaz's recounting of how he responded to her, even in thought when he heard about her reputation of her coming back. But the foreman also lets us know the other thing. It lets us know that Ruth didn't merely ask to glean. And I thought this was pretty cool. Because she could have just gleaned, and with approval, that could have happened. I don't even know if she would have had to have asked for approval, but she wanted approval. Please let me glean and gather among the sheaves. Let me go to your bundles that are tied and take from those as well. And I take from that potentially a couple things. One, gleaning was so sparse, at this point she's worked for a morning, that she has very little to even bring back. So where she's saying to this foreman, when she got to Boaz's field, she comes to this foreman, please let me glean, yes. Follow the rules that are prescribed by your law. Let me take from the sheaves. Let me take from your bundles that your reapers have harvested and tied together. That is an audacious request. Let me take from your employees' work. Let me put my hand in your pocket. Ruth is an audacious and brave woman. She's standing in the promises of God and then wanting more. She is maybe desperate. Hungry stomach. Naomi's at home, hungry. She wants more. She wants to provide for Naomi. She wants to be able to come back to Naomi with plenty. Naomi left Bethlehem full. Ruth wants her to be full again. And if that's the case, since she's asking for more, verse 7, the last half of it, so she came and has continued from early morning until now, except for a short rest, is probably one of the most contested verses in the entire book of Ruth. Commentators are split between two major interpretations. That my reading actually kind of takes the middle view, I would say, between the two. So my Bible, the ESV, reads, so she came and she has continued from early morning until now, except for a short rest. That can mean that she came and she either continued standing there waiting for her request because the foreman would not have the authority to say, go ahead and take from the sheaves. That's not the foreman's crops. That's Boaz's crops. He would have had to have waited for authority. Or it could mean she continued gleaning but not taking from the sheaves until that time. Or she just stood resolutely like, I'll wait. I'll wait for Boaz. He may be coming. I'll wait for authority to come and take from your sheaves. And it may mean that she came and continued waiting until, except for a short rest, and then that verse also can mean standing like a house, standing like a dwelling. So it could mean that she was like, I am expecting, I want the Lord to provide for me. We're desperate. I want some sheaves. How much time you got? So she just waits. Or it could mean, and either way you take this, I think Ruth looks good. The other way you can take it is she gleaned. She continued gleaning from what was left, didn't touch a sheaf. She's not going to take, she's asked for permission. She wouldn't have even asked for permission if she would take. Or she continued working as much as his hired hands did and only taking a rest at high noon. So either way you take it, I really think that Ruth's character plays out and plays out really well. She's playing out expectantly. The Lord will provide for me. And then if we take the way that if she's just standing resolutely, it's almost like the foreman saying, can you believe her? She hasn't even moved. And then Boaz responds. Boaz said to Ruth, doesn't even answer the foreman, which is kind of cool. Verse 8, Boaz said to Ruth, now listen, my daughter. At this point, he now knows who she is. She is fatherless. She's husbandless. She's brotherless. She's a Moabite in a foreign land. He's saying, listen, my daughter. When those words hit the lips of Boaz and consequently hit the ears of Ruth, I guarantee you her shoulders drop. Oh, here comes the faithfulness of God through the hand of humans. Listen, my daughter. Do not go to glean in another field or leave this one. That's a testimony to how unsafe it was for women at this time. But keep close to my young women. Keep close to his hired hands. Be like my servants. Be like my reapers. Verse 9, let your eyes be on the field that they are reaping and go after them. Don't miss a head of grain that falls. Pick it up and go after them. Have I not charged the young men not to touch you? There's a presumption of this is Boaz's field. He operates differently. Men, keep your hands off of the women. It's a man of worthy character. verse 1, did not lead us astray by saying he was a worthy man. Have I not charged the young men not to touch you? And when you are thirsty, go to the vessels and drink what the young men have drawn, completely countercultural to the world of that time. Women drew the water for the men. Only out of necessity would a man draw the water himself. And he says, drink what the men have drawn. There is shelter underneath the wings of God Most High. And lest we just get thought lost in the ethereal nature of that promise and how it plays out, he uses people to do it. This is God, again, weaving that tapestry together, letting us know that this may look like chaos from one perspective, but from God's perspective, this is exactly how he has it played out. Verse 10, Ruth responds, and she fell on her face, bowing to the ground, and said to him, why have I found favor in your eyes that you should take notice of me, since I am a foreigner? She went expectantly and is still, wow, God, thank you. Because she knows she doesn't deserve it. She hasn't done anything to earn this. Nothing in her past or in her history has made God, mandated God to provide for her. She has seen Naomi suffer. And when he responds, when God responds, she responds in absolute thankfulness. And Boaz answered her, all that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband has been fully told to me, and how you left your father and mother and your native land and came to a people that you did not know before. So the story had gone and it had hit the ears of Boaz. And he responds in verse 12, the Lord repay you for what you have done, and a full reward be given you by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge. Boaz is saying, yeah, I'm giving you refuge, but ultimately it's God. God uses people. We don't take the credit. We give it all to God. God is the one who is providing her this refuge. And then she said, verse 13, I have found favor in your eyes, my Lord, for you have comforted me and spoken kindly to your servant, though I am not one of your servants. We assume now that there's a time break between verses 13 and 14, because then there's an and at mealtime. So she may have went back into the fields and she may have gleaned. At this point, she is still only gleaning. Boaz has not said to go ahead and take from the sheaves. So she goes and she gleans. And then verse 14, at mealtime, Boaz said to her, come here, come to my table, and eat some bread. Don't just eat the dry bread. Dip it in the wine. Let that moist bread hit your lips. Dip your morsel in the wine. So she sat beside the reapers, inclusion, and he passed to her roasted grain. This is a literally passing by his hand. This isn't a handing of a plate, or it made its way to her. He passed to her by his hand. He served her roasted grain. This is covenant language here. And she ate until she was satisfied, and she had some left over. And you have to wonder, and we're only going to go through 16 here, at this point, when she had some left over, if Naomi was on her mind. I'm full, I'm bringing this back to Naomi. The Lord has been good. She may not have had much in her basket by way of gleaning, given the hard times, given the fact that they're coming out of a famine. And then verse 15, when she rose to glean, Boaz instructed his young men, saying, let her glean even among the sheaves, and do not reproach her. Even among what's already been cut, bound, and ready for picking up. And then pull out some from the bundles for her, and leave it for her to glean, and do not rebuke her. Take some out. Maybe even saving her humility a little bit. Saying, just even take it out of the bundles and let her grab it so that she's not seen taking it from the sheaves, even if she does. That's mercy and grace. That is a God, that is a guy who is focusing and trusting only in his almighty God for his stance, if you will. And that is a God who's merciful and who provides for his people, who cares for his people, and who surprises his people. Ruth was shocked. She was absolutely shocked. I love the fact that this happened to fall on a day in which we're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper. Because there's only one reason why we can approach the table. It's only because of Jesus Christ. Only because of his sin-atoning sacrifice. For your sins and mine, yesterday, today, and tomorrow, When God invites us to his table, he doesn't merely say, take what's left over. He says, take from the bundles. Take from my excess. You know, if we were to merely glean from God, we would probably only get to forgiveness. And that sounds pretty good, doesn't it? Forgiveness? It's a great thing. But we've sinned against a perfect and holy God, right? We stand in debt to him. We stand worthy and we deserve his wrath. The Bible makes it clear that his wrath lasts for eternity. Right? Amen. And so for us to receive forgiveness, that is marvelous. God takes you from an unpayable sin debt and brings you to forgiveness. He brings you to a balance of zero. But he doesn't leave you at gleaning. He says, go ahead and take from my sheaves. Go ahead and have Christ's righteousness on your behalf. Mere neutrality will not get you entrance into heaven. Because we couldn't even remain neutral if we were given a chance. Like, we couldn't just sit and do nothing. Go, I can't sin. Because we must bring glory to God. What are we going to be doing for eternity? If this bores you, maybe I've done a terrible job explaining glorifying God. We will be glorifying God for eternity, seeing his awesomeness from perspectives uneven imagined in this state of existence. He grants us his righteousness, Christ's righteousness, his sinless perfection, so that we can get granted entrance into heaven. It's gleaning and taking from the sheaves. Romans 3 kind of captures this for us, this thought. Romans 3 is a wonderful treatment on righteousness, if you will, and how it's obtained. It's obtained through faith. So Romans 3, verse 21 says, but now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and prophets bear witness to it. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. We get forgiveness. We get granted righteousness. It takes us from an unpayable sin debt to an immeasurable wealth of Christ's righteousness. God in perfection's righteousness gets credited to your account. Forgiveness is great. That brings us to neutral. His righteousness is well done, my good and faithful servant. It's that then that we then walk in through the Holy Spirit's power, calling us to become more and more like Christ each and every day. And it was to show his righteousness at the present time so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus Christ, which earlier Paul tells us gets us righteousness. And it all comes back to who Christ is and his sacrifice on the cross. So I ask you this morning, before we come to the table, before you come to dip your bread in the wine, if you will, is it Christ alone that you are trusting in for your salvation? It's maybe easy to put our mind around a little bit. That's where faith is. Because so often our flesh will want to creep back in and say, I can help out. You've thrown me the life preserver, but I'll kick while you hold me. It's not. You cling empty-handedly to that life raft of Christ's blood. His body broken for you. Spilled for the cutting of the new covenant of grace. And it's when we come to the table, we've been invited to come to the table, that we, again, practice what Christ has done for us. We embody it. We preach the gospel. The Bible talks about communion. We're all preaching the gospel because we're saying here in covenant language that we're completely reliant upon you, Christ, for our everything. I'm not trusting in my good works. I'm trusting only in Jesus Christ and his perfect sin-atoning righteousness. If that's not you this morning, I ask you to contend with that fact. It's in Scripture. It's there for us. Trust only in Jesus Christ. And if this is the morning when God calls you to faith and where you're trusting only in him, then come and receive the blessing of the Lord's Supper for the first time as a believer. It's an element of grace because we're reminded of what Christ has done for us. Christ said to do it in remembrance of him. So let's transition now to our celebration of the Lord's Supper. We come to this table